Welcome to Hit Voice. This is your channel for exploring new issues and developments in healthcare and technology. I'm Karen Song. Today we'll be discussing the future of the internet and how technology can enhance patient care. Joining us today is Farzad Nazem, board member and platform thought leader for Apixio, who has pioneered many aspects of the internet. Farzad was the CTO of Yahoo for 11 years, and he is here to offer his perspectives. Farzad, thanks for joining us.
It's good to be here.
So tell us about yourself.
Well, I started as an early engineer in the mid-80s at Oracle. Our task was to build technology to store and retrieve lots of data by building databases and creating an environment where enterprises could manage all of their data that we're gathering because all the information was becoming digital and they needed to manage that. So we built those type of tools. In the mid-90s, the internet was starting and I wanted to be part of that revolution. So one of the great vantage points for that was Yahoo. It was a very young company at the time that I joined it. There were about 20 people and I was the founding CTO. And I was there for 11 years to about 2007. And during that time, we witnessed what happened with the internet and we were a participant and probably one of the key players in that era.
So what were some of the most exciting things for you to work on during that time?
What we set out to do was to see what really people wanted to do online and helping them to get online seamlessly and making it non-threatening. By getting all the information they wanted online and also enabling lots of things that would make them much more efficient, whether it was banking, they could do all of their banking stuff, whether it was getting information that they normally got from disparate sets of sources, whether it was finance, sports, news, whatever that might have been, mm-hmm. making it very seamless to get. Mm-hmm. And applications. And when it came to communication, I think there was a whole big revolution going on with email and instant messaging and those type of things, which we were pioneers in. So we really helped people to embrace this whole new revolution of how to come online and mm-hmm. basically take the world, it seems like, kind of to the next level.
Wow. Yeah. So, I mean, what was it like redefining the internet in the late 90s?
It was extremely exciting because we could see what the possibilities are. I mean, we wanted information to be available to everybody no matter where they were, whether they were on the computer or on their phone, having that accessible. And like I mentioned, the communication was a big part of it, how to make it so that people can exchange information and ideas in a very seamless, quick fashion.
So, I mean, what do you think of developments today, you know, in Facebook or Twitter, Groupon?
Right. Well, certainly we're now in the next phase of the internet. The first phase was more about interaction of an individual with either a device or a machine, whether it was mobile or computers, in kind of a one-on-one kind of interaction of, I'm looking for this thing, how do I find it? And then I would do something with it. Now it's a lot more about doing things together in more of a social way and having shared experiences.
Right.
So even if I want to go shopping, I want to know what my friends are thinking about it at the time, and it needs to be real time. My friends can keep track of me through Twitters and all that stuff, what's going on in my life, and I the same for theirs. And with Facebook, the whole young generation, basically, it has changed the way the young generation socializes today. And hopefully, it still will be healthy in the years to come, but there are some.
So you feel it is a little bit unhealthy?
It can become unhealthy, where if the only thing you interact with, there's always something between you and the other humans. It won't be a replacement, but an enhancement.
So what advice do you have for people in their late 20s who are working at these startups?
Basically, be careful as to not making it too impersonal, but push the envelope as much as possible. I'm not a sociologist, but I'm sure people can make adjustments and the societies will adjust themselves if it's going down too far down the wrong path. But I'm really excited by how much mobile has come along. I mean, mm-hmm. the potential for it has always been there. The devices were not as sophisticated in the late 90s. didn't have as much power, but nowadays that's no longer an issue. And as you can see, it's a whole new kind of a frontier where the interactions on those devices are very unique because you have location-based types services that really enable you to do brand new things, whether it's in the commerce-related areas, you can be walking by store and getting a coupon right there to entice you to go in, so it's a great opportunity for the advertisers. But it's also for consumers to have deals and being able to take advantage of those type of things.
If you were in your late 20s today, what projects would most intrigue you to work on?
Mobile, I think, is certainly one aspect of it, because as we move around, we're used to having so much information at our fingertips when we're next to the computer. Mobile is certainly one aspect of it. And the other parts are kind of adjacent industries, if you will, that really haven't benefited from all the evolution that has happened on the internet side and the consumer side of the world. Namely, when I look at, for example, biotech or health IT, I see that those areas have not really embraced those technologies as well as they should. Right. And there are lots of opportunities there to really make those industries a lot more advanced and kind of bring them up to the speed of everything else. So from that perspective, I think there are a lot of opportunities in the adjacent industries.
So what are you working on now?
Basically, when I retired from Yahoo, one of the things I wanted to look at is how best can I use my experience and the knowledge I gained to help out in fact, those two areas that I just mentioned, which I have a soft part in my heart for. Yeah. I think I can bring a lot to that space just because by the aid of technology, I think we can make a lot of improvement in those areas. And I also learn about those areas. I wanted something that was symbiotic from a standpoint of me learning something and also being able to give back to that. So I'm somewhat concentrating on those areas at the moment.
So this touches upon your involvement with Apixio.
Right.
What are you sort of learning the most from your experience?
Well, I have learned a fair amount as far as where the health IT world is today. And I have to say that it's, in my opinion, somewhat shocking where the state of the world is. You know, you go to a doctor and the doctor has 10, 15 minutes to spend with you and you see them turn around to a machine and, log in and kind of get your information, but you quickly find out that they don't really have all of your information. They ask you the same questions that maybe another doctor asked you. And you see them going through kind of a workflow type system, which seems very rigid. And it was absolutely shocking to me to see that it doesn't even have a search box.
Really?
which is something in my world, I mean, everything you do has a search box. So how can you navigate the way you want to navigate as opposed to being forced down a particular path? So the type of technologies that are used are, in my estimation, maybe 5, 10, 15 years old, depending on what you're really looking at. Mm-hmm. And they can be done a lot better. And that's where I saw Apixio can add a lot of value, because it's really trying to address that notion that there are all these information that are out there, but the way they're being implemented today is done in islands, because every organization feels like they can only control what they can control today.
Right.
So they buy software and implement it, and the way they approach it is, how do I make my, and the IT department, I guess, in those organizations, says, how do I make my constituency more efficient? Mm-hmm. Their constituencies are the caregivers, the doctors, the nurses, and all that. So they approach it from, okay, so if they go through these set of tasks and it seems like a workflow, then a workflow system is probably what they need.
Right.
The way I look at it is not really quite that way, in that the real customer is the patient.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to have more of a patient-centric approach to it, as in, if I'm dealing with a patient,
right,
how do I put the patient in the center and first, and find all the information about the patient? And
right,
because the way the world is today, at least. You don't go to a single doctor. You go to many different doctors, and the doctors span different organizations. And you certainly don't pick, okay, I'm going to go to this doctor because they happen to be on the same system as this other doctor that I went to.
That's not what goes through your head.
Right. No patient picks doctors that way.
Yeah.
So it would be wonderful if, in fact, every doctor could see everything that's all the information that's been gathered for this patient. It would make the whole thing a lot more efficient. Imagine that 10 minutes could be spent actually diagnosing the problem as opposed to re-asking the things that are already in some system somewhere, and having them be able to navigate it in a more natural way as opposed to, you know, it, through a workflow where it may or may not be in that path, at least what the patient is talking about. So those are some of the opportunities that I see.
Do you find it in some ways very bizarre that we haven't sort of implemented these technological advances or changes?
I don't know whether I would use the word bizarre, but it's unfortunate in that the technology is there. There is nothing that really has to be implemented from scratch that's so revolutionary that could not be done. The mobile devices are very capable today. I mean, the fact that if a doctor is not at their office, they should be able to get all their information about when they receive a call about a patient, to pull up all their information right there and be able to really add value in the right way without risk. All the getting information from different types of system and coalescing them and all of that.
That's the greatest challenge.
Right. It's a challenge because of the way it's been implemented, not because it should have been implemented that way. If it was implemented in a different way, it wouldn't have been as much of a challenge. So the world I come from, we approach it as all that information needs to be shared because we always put the consumer in the center and we looked at it from their point of view. So I think that made a big difference in the the way we laid out the information and we stored the information. So the retrieval of that information and coalescing it was much simpler than it is today. But it doesn't mean that it can't be done. The good news is that today the government, for example, has initiatives in place and legislation with carrots and sticks to get all these organizations to go electronic, because lots of the information today is basically in paper files and cabinets, which nobody can help with. So having all that information to be online, at least, that's a huge step in itself. And there are sticks as well as to if, you know, you don't go online and be able to have these capabilities, there are ramifications. So everybody's motivated in doing that. And interfaces have been defined that at least makes it possible to be able to tap in different islands of information and pull the data in a permissioned way, which is extremely important, for the user so that a caregiver can give get full access to all the information and be able to act upon those in a very timely manner.
So in some sense, this is the perfect storm of...
Yeah, I totally see it as where the healthcare cost has gone up to a point that has everyone's attention. The regulations and government have taken steps to make it possible for the information to become available online and in a predefined way. And the technology is there to do it. So finally, there is enough money, will, and that I see a whole big revolution like I saw in the 95-96 timeframe for the internet, that all of these forces are coming together and finally we're going to see big moves happening in this area.
So the technology is there.
Yes. It's the willingness is there and the money is there.
We just need to sort of...
go execute it.
Execute, right?
Yep. So I'm very hopeful.
Well, thank you very much for your time, Zod. It's been a pleasure.
It was great talking to you.
Thank you for watching Hit Voice. All our episodes will be available at www.apixio.com. And feel free to submit questions, ideas, or suggestions for future guests and shows to hitvoice@apixio.com. Thanks for being here with us.